Okay, so today we have a talk with François Zapuan. She'll talk about topological large fields and transfer results.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the invitation for talking here. Okay, so it's with some model theory in this talk and a little bit of differential algebra. So this is a joint work with Pablo Cubides, who is now in Caen. And I apologize for the two logicians because I have already given a version of his talk. Okay. It just starts a little differently, but it's basically the same. So the outline is first, so I will place myself in some class of fields which has some properties, so they have some topology, underlying topology, like an order or evaluation. So they are large, we see more precisely what it means. So don't worry about quantified elimination for now. And what we do, the problem we are interested in, is just we add a derivation and we look at the differential expansions and ask ourselves, can we describe the existentially closed elements in this class? So existentially closed means that if you have an extension, and you have some system of differential equation true in that extension is already true in your field. It's a bit simplified version. Okay, so
do you require any interaction between derivation and topology?
This is a good question. No.
Okay.
So this is completely say, orthogonal to what say van den Dries, Aschenbrenner, and van der Hoeven has been doing with the fields of transseries, which were, in some sense, modeling Hardy fields, where you have a strong interaction between the derivation and the topology. So this is not the case here, okay? And it's more in the space, okay, so we just see why one would be interested in doing this. So then, I mean, we are interested in transfer properties from the original class, so the fields without the derivation and the differential expansions. Immediate means that, I mean, it will be immediate once we have described this class, which I call T star D. And then some more transfer result. For instance, what can you say about continuous definable functions? Elimination of image and open core. Well, I will define all these terms afterwards. And then one of the applications of putting no interaction between the topology and the derivation is that we get some application to the theory of dense pairs. So, I mean, one can readily see that if you have a differential field, you have the field of constants, so you have a pair of fields. So the examples that of topological fields that I will be interested in are the following. So I will denote by k-bar just a field. So since I'm a model theorist, I'm interested in which language I'm going to talk about. So field language for a start. And then I had an order. And as I said, I will be interested in large fields, and this will reflect in the fact that in the ordered case, for instance, I will be interested in real closed fields. So real closed field just means that it's a field which is elementary equivalent, so has the same first order properties as the field of real numbers. So in green, I put all minimal theory. Why? Because, I mean, in the model theoretic sense, one of the key features of this class of fields is that definable set in one dimension are just finite union of intervals, as it is true in the real numbers. So now you can consider valued fields. So you can consider so the periodic valuation and complete, say, the rational numbers. So have, so to have QP. And and the theory of QP is called a field which is elementary equivalent. So the same properties as QP is called the p-adically closed valued fields. So of rank one, so you can slightly generalize to rank D to get finite algebraic extensions of QP. And in green again, I mean, this is an example, maybe, of a p-minimal theory. So then you can mix, if you look at non-standard models of real closed fields, so take a non-principal ultra product, you get a convex subset, so convex subrings, so an equivalence relation. You can put then an equivalence relation which says that two elements are Archimedean equivalent. And so naturally you get a valuation, which is not necessarily that one, but you can study the model theory of this kind of field. So it's the ordered, real closed, and value with a valuation. And this theory is called RCVL. Doesn't matter. So it's also a prototype example of what is called weakly hominimal theory. So again, I mean, they're characterized by what the definable subsets in one dimension look like. And here, it's not necessarily, you don't ask that the endpoint of intervals belong to the definable sets, like the valuation ring of your field. And then if you forget about the order now, just stay with the valuation, you have what is called non-trivially valued algebraically closed field. So the underlying field is algebraically closed, and you put a valuation.
And
I have
a question.
Yes?
Why do you call them topological?
Because there is a topology in it. An order or valuation? And yes, so what I said before is that I'm not interested, I will put now a derivation on these fields, but I will not assume that there is any interaction between the topology and the derivation. That's what I'm doing.
Okay, so this is just for general information.
Sorry?
Or it's just a...
No, I will be interested in this kind of topological fields. I will add a derivation. And see what happens.
Okay.
But there will be no interaction between the derivation and the topology. Okay.
But like in general, we cannot encode topology on a field in first order language, right?
It's why I add, in real closed field, you can say something is positive.
yes, but
square.
But
okay?
If I just want to characterize like all topological fields, right? I cannot write.
No. I fix a topology on my field.
Okay?
Uh-huh. So okay. I take a field, I fix a topology on it, and possibly I add either extra symbols to speak about this topology, if I cannot do it in the language of fields.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, so you can say these fields are very different, but what one of the common algebraic property is that they are large, which means that which is a property introduced by Florian Popp, which means that they are existentially closed in the field of Lorentz series. Okay, so any system of equation of integration which is true in the field of Lorentz series with parameters in the small field K is already true in K. Okay. And you can, if it's true for K of T, it's also true for some iteration, K of T1T. And, one can just use that. So if you are not familiar with existentially closed, another way of saying this is that you can embed, so you have A and B, and you can embed B in an ultra power of A by an embedding which is fixed on A. Okay. It's another way of saying that something is existentially closed. So I did put this. I knew that most of you are not model theorists, but for me it's a nice result. So even for you, you are not required to know what is DP minimal or not DP minimal. So it's some kind of stability-like property, and which is defined in the following way. So by its negation, so you say that a certain configuration does not occur in M. Okay. So what is xi and yj? You can view it as a two-dimensional grid, and you have some elements aij. Yes.
Could you speak a little louder? Just the acoustics of the room, so that in the back it's a little harder to hear.
Okay. Okay.
That's sweet. Like the other room.
Okay. Okay. Okay, so if I face you, it's okay, it's better?
It's great. No.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, sorry. Well, but when I cannot push this button. Okay, well, anyway, so this is a model theoretic property. And what is nice about it, okay, is that from this abstract property, you can show the following. And this has been shown. Yes?
Can we So what's unary definable?
Yeah.
Unary just mean subset of M. It's just that.
Ah, so just definable subsets.
Yes.
Ah, okay.
But it's just, this M is not some power of M.
Ah.
It's like unary.
Ah, okay. So like one dimension.
Binary would just be M squared. Okay.
Ah, I see.
Okay, sorry.
Okay.
Oh,
now that's perfect.
Okay. You just, I'm used to certain vocabulary and I don't pay any attention. So please do interrupt. Okay. So this property, which is abstract, but what is nice about it, this was proved by a student of Scanlon with Johnson, is that from this abstract property, you can show that, so forget for a moment non-strongly minimal, just mean that not looking like complex numbers, then, if a field has this abstract property, then you can, he showed that you can define a topology on it. Okay? Of course, there are dot, dot, dots. It just means that you allow yourself to work in the language which contains the language of wings, but which might be richer, like you can add order, valuation, etc. Okay? So from this non-existence of this, say, definable two-dimensional grid, he showed that all these fields can be endowed with a non-discrete Hausdorff definable field topology. Okay. So this uniformly definable basis of neighborhood zero just means that maybe I can write it on the board.
Could you write it on that board?
Oh, okay. But you have a formula, just one formula phi.
No, on that board, because it can't see.
Oh, yes, please.
Okay.
And may I also ask, expansion, is it a synonym for extension?
Expansion means you have a richer language,
Expansion,
you increase the domain.
So I don't change the set, I add new symbols.
Yes,
I see.
As in the example that I gave.
I see, okay, yeah. good. Now it's more clear. Okay.
You have a formula with some parameters, x, z, and if I put k, then if you look at the set of all elements of k which satisfy this formula, this is a neighborhood of zero. In k, okay? And if you vary, you can describe like. Okay, just it's a fancy way to say that. An example of this kind, such a formula is just interval around zero. Okay. Mm-hmm. And Moreover, I mean, you can say, well, it might be strange, any kind of formulas, but in fact, what his result says that we stay in more or less, we stay in the class of example that I've given at the beginning of my talk. So the topology is either induced by a non-trivial valuation or an order. And then you have some definable, so you have this topology, so you can say which further properties do you have. So any definable subset of K is finite boundary. And if you have an infinite definable set, it has non-empty integer. Okay. So in particular, this will be useful in afterwards. You can bound a uniformly definable family of finite sets, which means that if you have a formula phi, so now suppose you have a formula phi, and suppose suppose when you vary the parameters, this is finite. This means that you can bound the cardinality of this family of finite sets, provided you get your finite sets by like this, taking a formula and varying the parameters. Okay, so. Okay, so then I mean, to go a little further in this kind of theory of topology, certain topological fields. So now I'm going to describe some results of Pierre Simon and Eric Walsberg. And so they show, so again in this context of DP topology, okay, that you have, in some sense, objects that are familiar. So you have topological fields, you have a notion of topological dimension. You have, which is defined as usual. So we are, well, model theorists. And so you have also the notion of model theoretic dimension, which generalizes what happens for linear dimension or algebraic dimension. So you first define the dimension of a tuple, saying this, that it is a maximal, the length of a maximal subtuple. Say independent subtuple, and you define the dimension of a set, saying that is the maximal dimension of the elements which belongs to this. So it's really modeling, say, of the algebraic linear dimension. But maybe surprisingly, just for small story, they do not assume that this. Algebra model theoretic dimension X exchange property. Yes. But what is interesting for us is that they show that this topological dimension coincides with this, say, model theoretic dimension, or if you prefer. Okay. And so we'll use the symbol dim for any of these two dimensions.
Could you clarify how this U bar is connected to X?
It belongs to X. So I define the dimension of a tuple, and then the dimension of a set.
Okay. I see.
Like you would do in linear algebra. Well,
I see.
And so maybe I should put the whole slides. So in that context, they did generalize what is called a cell decomposition theorem due to Larry Matthews, which applied to the example that I gave you before, so real closed fields, the real closed valued fields, and periodically closed fields. So R, QP, real closed valued fields, not the last ones, the last one. And this, you can also, I mean, this cell decomposition theorem are like what happens in real closed field in semi-algebraic geometry. Okay.
So I need so a correspondence. I suppose everybody knows what it is. Well, it's just a multi-valued function with multi-valued but finitely valued function. And M is just means that the fibers are of the same cardinality M. And so using this notion of correspondence, so the cell decomposition theorem is as follows. You take a definable set in some product of your field K, so always assuming that it's DP minimal. So it can be decomposed as a finite union of sets XI, which are either open sets or a graph of, say, a function over an open set. So Ui is a definable open set. And so to encompass open set, just you can have just open sets. So Ui is a subset of Kd, so when d equals n, so the full dimension, you recover open sets, and if d equals zero, you will recover finite set. Okay? So you can view this theorem as an analog of what happens in the real numbers. And using this theorem, they prove the further property of a dimension. They show that the dimension of a boundary is strictly smaller than the dimension of your set X. So in some sense, what happens usually, say. Okay, so now I'm going to look at differential expansions of my fields. So we start over. So we take a topological field of character. All my fields will be from now on of characteristic zero. So you have, as we saw, a definable family of neighborhoods of zero, so which will be described by a formula chi, which is. But on our language, so we say that we take expansion of a ring language, so we just assume that we add relations and not functions. So for instance, if you take the field of Riolz with the exponential function, it does not enter in this setting. And furthermore, so we'll assume that the theory admits quantified elimination, which means that any definable set can be described by a formula without any quantifiers. Okay, so it's set of solutions of, say if it was just the ring language, any definable set is the set of solution of a system of equation and inequations. So very simple set. No projections. And so the examples that I described at the beginning of my talk do fall under this hypothesis. Of course, we have to replace this valuation by a relation. And so we simply say that we associate with V. V was a symbol for the valuation. We associate the following relations, which we call div. So we say that A and B are in relation if V of A is less or equal to V of B. And so this theory is, so real closed field and quantified elimination is the result of Alfred Tarski in the 40s. Then QP and quantified elimination is, relation symbol Pn x just says that x is an nth power. So this was a result of Angus McIntyre in the 70s, I suppose. Then for real closed valued fields, this is a result of Charlin and Dickman in the 80s. And for algebraically closed valued field, it's the result of Abraham Robinson in late 50s, I think.
have a question.
Yes.
So for the Tarski work.
Yes.
So it was followed by a lot of further algorithmic development and implementation to make it more efficient.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. And user friendly.
Yeah.
What about the other words, 2 through 4? So has this progressed, and what would be the clients of such an algorithm? Who would use that?
I don't know. Who would be interested to have efficient elimination for these further theories? I don't know about QP, maybe for QP. I don't know if one would be interested in that. Yeah, but I don't know. Okay. No, no, but true that I know a lot of works, I mean, as you say, for real plus fit.
Or anyone derives and does algorithms in that theory.
So the proofs of these
yes.
are not constructive.
Oh, well, I mean, yes, I mean, for instance, Cohen gave some constructive
ones,
but and what I'm saying, I don't know if this was followed by really trying to maximize the efficiency or this kind of thing. So this was, I mean, at least for QP, this was constructive.
And do you know what motivated them to consider these problems?
It just, I mean, you have what can consider as interesting structures, and you want to see what, so you have a language, so you are interested in definable sets, so you are interested in understanding the shape of this definable set. So if you know that you can define them just not using any quantifiers, but this point, so case of QP, so the second bullet, just these PNs, well, it's a nice, I mean, for instance, Deneff used this quantifier elimination for his work on Poincaré series. I mean, this led, at least in periodically closed fields, to application. So this was used, I mean, at least for the second bullet, this was useful. Okay. And it's still useful.
So what about the other cases, for example, the second line if n equals 0?
Sorry?
You said n greater than or equal to 1. What if it is equal to 0?
No, but I mean...
Like in this third line. Oh. It's a different theory, of course, but...
What I mean is that you have to add all these pns to get quantifier elimination. And when n equals 0, it just means that it's not why do 0 equals 1?
Oh,
it's not
this particular pn.
Yeah. So, I mean, you don't have quantifier elimination in the wing language, this you know. And
no
then you don't have quantifier elimination for any of these theories, I think, in the wing language.
Mm-hmm.
And the question you ask yourself is, what do you have to add to get quantifier elimination?
Oh, okay.
Okay. This is a question.
And what are approximately the years of these results?
I think I said it. I mean, so this is late 50s. This is beginning of 80s.
I haven't impressed anyone, but...
This is McIntyre's... late 70s, Prestel rocket is in the 80s, when it was 1D is bigger than 1, strictly bigger than 1, and Tarski in the 40s. So it's a long time ago.
But the developments in terms of algorithms...
Okay, so Cohen proved effective quantifier elimination early, I mean, in the 50s or 60s. And the applications of Deneff for QP, for second theory, it's the 80s. Okay. Sorry?
Oh, I was just wondering about PNIC applications.
Oh, it's just work of Deneff
on Poincaré series. For instance, he also wanted to calculate integrals to have number theoretic applications. So if you want to calculate integrals, the fact that the definable sets are quite simple then makes the calculation easy.
What is the role played by the word binary in the DIME?
So I mean, if I have a valuation, so normally it goes from the field to the value group. So it goes, say, outside of the the field you are working in. Okay, so you want to replace this function from the field to the ordered group, the value group, by some relation which is intrinsic, which is inside your field. And binary, but I mean, it's a binary relation. It's a between two elements. So here, I mean, I define it here. I mean, you say
I know what binary means. I'm asking.
Sorry. It's just to stay in your field. But it's not, in fact, I mean, it's just
I mean,
a technical.
What about a tertiary relation? What about something else?
But this is what we need.
Mm-hmm. In this example, we just need that binary relation
to get quantifiable elimination. This is what we need.
That's what you need.
And the rest of it.
So you well.
I don't know how many people.
So a unary relational world of
that's
non
that's what it seems like.
That's how I'm excited about
it. Or a tertiary?
Well, I mean, always make a binary relation. Tertiary in a different way.
So you
really that's true.
Yep.
But not every tertiary comes
correct.
From a binary.
Correct.
And so,
just in the last one.
If DIV were a tertiary relation, do we have any result like that?
It would be a less good result because we want to make things simple, and tertiary is more complicated than binary.
So you see,
but a quantifier elimination result is reducing complicated to simple, and so the simpler your answer, the better.
You want to
if I want quantifier elimination, whereas the language has a tertiary relation. You're not interested?
Yes, we are, but it's not necessary.
But this is a result of what I end with.
Yes.
I start with just the
field. I understand that.
Also, sometimes after doing quantifier elimination, the formula actually becomes gigantic. Right? So it can happen.
Anywhere.
Yeah, possibly.
It's simple, even to read.
I mean, simple mean I don't have to project a set to get what I'm interested in.
So what about quantifier introduction?
Sorry?
What about quantifier introduction?
What is quantifier introduction?
So you introduce a quantifier to simplify the formula.
Oh, I mean, it depends on your notion of a simple formula, okay? My notion of a simple formula, sorry? Okay, so here, I mean, in this talk, simple formula is just formula without quantifiers, okay?
Next.
Okay, yes?
Do you have elimination of imaginaries in LP?
Yes. Okay, so I will come to that, thank you. Good question. I have finally introducing my derivation, but I suppose this you are familiar with all this. So I have this say real closed field, I have derivation on it. Okay. And
that's good.
Is it okay?
That's good. No continuity assumptions on
W. This makes life easier, yes.
Yeah.
But maybe not so interesting, I don't know. Since we do have quantifier elimination, one consequence of this is that all the models that I described in the previous slides were existentially closed. Okay, and you want to have to describe adding this derivation, so another symbol to your language, we want to describe the existentially closed models of existentially closed expansions, differential expansions. Okay. And you ask yourself under which condition it is, can you do it? Okay, so
I will give you the answer and then tell you why. Okay, so this is just a recap in some sense. We have a class of models, you had a derivation, and I want to describe a set of axioms describing what are the existentially closed differential fields in this setting, okay, with this underlying topology. So this is completely complicated looking formula, just means that you can describe a neighborhood of zero in some Kn. Okay. And so I suppose you are in some sense familiar with this. So the property we ask, on our differential expansion is the following. So you take a differential polynomial in one variable, f of x, you associate with it, so suppose it's as order n, well, this n, and this n has nothing to do. So you associate with it an ordinary polynomial, so algebraic polynomial, so in x, x1, xn. And you ask the following. So suppose you have an algebraic zero of this algebraic polynomial. So this is a separand, which is simple. That does not annihilate the separand. Then you want a differential solution, Z, which is close to this algebraic solution. Okay? So you look at differential expansions which do satisfy this set of axioms. And for me, it was important to write it in a first order way while using formulas. That is why, we have all this apparatus about being able to describe the neighbors of zero, okay, by a formula. This is not important. So the important thing is this condition. Okay. So is it okay?
Could you keep it for?
Yeah, just a second.
Yeah. If you're interested, I can send you my slides. You don't need to.
I would like to understand.
Sorry?
Has that something to do with being differential closed already?
Yes, exactly. But so this is a generalization of what is the theory that Michael Singer described, closed outward fields. And it's not total, it's not really differentially closed, but it's as close as we can be to being differentially closed, because the underlying, if you want an order, you cannot be algebraically closed. You cannot be algebraically, okay? So you want to keep the topology. So the best you can do is saying that for any formula such that, for any polynomial such that you do have an algebraic solution, you have a differential one. You cannot hope for more, if you don't want to destroy the underlying topology. Okay? Okay, so
that's all he needed.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
So it's natural in some sense. And of course, you can ask, do these kind of models exist? Does this set of axioms really describe the existentially closed differential expansions of the fields that we were starting with? Okay, and the answer is yes. And under a condition that we call T-largeness, which in some sense, the same property that I described before of being large. Okay, so the precise result is the following. So it was a result with Nicolas Guzzi. So you start with a class of topological fields. So T large, I will come back to it, of characteristic zero. So again, you assume that it has quantum elimination. And then this theory that I described, so T star D is just this theory TD, so you just add TD just T with an axiom saying that delta is a derivation. And then DL is just this scheme of, so for any differential polynomial in one variable, you write down this axiom. Okay. So T the scheme of X. So the result is that this theory that I just described is a right one. And again, you have quantified elimination. So in adding with this derivation, again, the definable set have a simple form. So it's okay.
The axiom has these quantifiers.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter. I mean, so if you take the theory of algebraic low closed fields,
quantifier free axiom then?
No. I mean, so no. Suppose you take the theory. Algebraically closed fields. Okay, so you say that any polynomial is a zero. Okay, this theory was almost the first, not the first one, I don't know, but it admits quantified elimination, so, okay? But of course, I mean, to describe the theory, you need some axioms involving quantifiers. You have to express the properties of your field, like any polynomial is a zero. Okay, so let me, maybe I should, I mean, so let me go, I mean, so T large is just some, so let me go over it, I mean, it's just, the property of being large in this different, in this topological setting, just, so under this condition, you do have this, the theory that I described as models, and describe the existentially closed differential expansions. So in the example that I gave you.
So are these proved case by case or general?
No, I mean, so you prove a general theorem that I gave, and then you apply it. Okay. And what I want to mention is that, maybe for the model theory, is that, of course, I place myself in the beginning of my talk in the setting of DP minimal theories, but there are examples for which you can apply the apparatus that I just described, which are not DP minimal, which are, for instance, fields with several orders, PRC fields or pseudo-periodically closed fields, and this kind of, the setting which I place myself was not really necessary. Okay. And so in all the examples that I gave you, one can describe this existentially closed differential expansion. And in the first case, so closed ordered differential fields, this was done by Michael Singer a long time ago. Okay. So to come to elimination of imaginaries, in front of this audience, I don't need to do this, but just to review the notations. So a term, say, think of a term like a polynomial, and so you associate an ordinary differential polynomial. So to a term with the derivation, you can associate a term in the original language L, so without the derivation. And so you denote it as we did with for polynomials by T star, and you make the derivatives appear. And since we show that we have quantified elimination, we can also, I mean, a quantified free formula is just a Boolean combination of formula of a form, some term equals zero, or some relation holds between two terms or three terms. Mm-hmm. So what is important is that with any quantified free formula, so in the language with the derivation, you can associate a formula in the original language, so without the derivation, but making the derivatives appear. Okay? And since, I mean, you have a derivation, and we don't have any more function symbols in our language, we can really we have really this equivalent, so just using the Leibniz rule, and the fact it's a morphism. Okay. And so Okay, so what I call the jet of a set is just taking a set, I look at the successive derivatives of an element. So delta m of a is just the set of its derivatives up to order m. And you can do it for subset of kn. And the fact that this theory that I described, t-star-d and this quantified elimination, means that if you take any definable set in this, with this derivation, it's of a form the jet minus one of some quantified free L definable set. So it's a way to go back. So I was, at the beginning of my talk, I was saying that I was interested in transfer result. So it's a way to go back to the original L definable set. And as you can define the order of a polynomial, you can define an order, the order of a definable set, just saying that M as X as order M if this M is minimal such, when Y is an L definable set. Okay. So the usual notion, I mean the expected notions. So as I the first from the axiomatizations and the quantified elimination results, so we have the two sets of transfer results. So first, I mean, well, it's not first one is not really a transfer result. It's just the observation that the field of constants is dense. Okay, so from this you can. From this you can deduce the fact that the differential valued field described by Rosenlicht are not more or less orthogonal to this, because the class of differential valued fields that Rosenlicht considered, for him, I mean, the valuation wing can be decomposed as a field of constants plus the maximal ideal. So this is, I mean, here the field of constants is dense. Okay. And then you can, since there is no derivation on the field of constants, you can ask yourself, is it this field of constants, is it a model of T? And the answer is yes. And then given a model of your theory with the derivation, you get a pair of models of T, okay? A dense pair of models of T. And then using this quantified elimination result, and so going as in my previous slide, from a formula with a derivation to a formula without it, but just making the successive derivatives appear, you can show these two model theoretic properties. But so let me just NIP is just a larger class than DP minimal, and this style is of a property. I don't want to go into that. But let me mention that, so at the beginning of my talk, I say that I assume that T was DP minimal. And one can show easily that this property is not transferred to that T star D. Okay, so now I want to go to this elimination of imaginary. So I will just go to. Okay, so this result about transfer of elimination of imaginaries is based on the following property. So on the fact that we are able to, with a definable set in this expanded language, so LD language, you can associate an L definable set where the differential points are dense. Okay. And so more formally, so let me state the property we are after. So you start with X LD definable set. The property we're after is to be able to find an L definable set Z such that when you take the closure of Z, you get the closure of the
mJet of x. And the first property is just saying that, so we call that you had a formula in this differential language. We associate a formula in this L language. And more or less, I mean, first approximation, I mean, if you want to do this, well, say, well, I take Z, the set of elements which satisfies this formula, phi star. So I suppose I want to go over this and just. So let me define this open core property. So we say that you start with K, a model of T, you add this derivation. Well, I don't know if I'm sorry, I might have put D or delta, but anyway. So D or delta means derivation. So you say that it's L open core if you have a definable set defined in this expansion, which is open, then it's L definable. Okay. So saying that if you restrict your attention to, in this expansion, to open set, you can just forget about the derivation. And to be able to associate with an LD definable set with this L definable set, so this property that I call star, is equivalent to have L open core. So maybe the easy direction, well, it's rather immediate, I mean. So you take you start with this set X, which is LD definable. You take its closure. So if you have L open core, this closure is L definable. Sorry. I want to go to the forward direction. Sorry. Yes. So what you want to show? Sorry. So you start with an LD definable set, and you want to show that its closure is L definable. And you suppose that you have your set Z such that if you take the jet, which has property star. So what's this property? So if you take the closure of Z, you have it's equal to the closure of a jet M of X. And then they are linked by saying that if x, little x, belongs to the set, the jet M of x belongs to C. Okay. And so what you do, you just take the closure of x, you check that the closure of x is the projection, the closure of a projection of the closure of C. So since Z was L definable, since the topology is definable, you get that your closure, X bar is definable, is L definable. Okay. And then, I mean, you can do show that if the theory is L open core, then you can find such set Z, L definable sets. Okay. So now, I mean, going to this elimination of imaginaries result, which in some sense the main result. So let me say in some simple term what is elimination of imaginaries. So the rough idea is just saying that you have to be able to, with a definable set, to associate a code. So what do you mean by a code? It is something which has a property if you take any automorphism of your structure, and if it leaves the set invariant, if you leave, it leaves your code fixed. Okay. And the transfer result that we were after is the following. So you assume that your original theory admits elimination of imaginaries. You might expand your language
in order to achieve that. Suppose you have a dimension function on your definable set. Mm-hmm. So I showed that this old if t was dp minimal. And furthermore, suppose that this theory is L open core, so you have you are able to associate with any LD definable set this L definable set Z. Then under all these hypotheses, then you do have a transfer. I mean, you don't have to add any more. You don't need to expand your language anymore to get that your differential expansion, this theory describing the existentially closed differential expansions, then this theory also admits elimination of imaginary set.
And this expansion is a definitional expansion?
For instance, sorry? The G, I mean, for instance, is for ACVF, you add the geometry.
But it's always a definitional expansion. So you're not actually adding new structure, you're just naming stuff that...
Yeah, naming stuff, So I name in, and in case of closed ordered fields, I don't need to add anything. And the, maybe what, the interest...
What has dimension to do with this?
Okay, so well, because of the following, so we try to for this, I mean, so the fact that CODF admits elimination of imaginary is now several proofs, okay? But one proof, which was given by Martin Stressel, was following the idea of working by induction on the dimension. So you need a dimension, okay? And so you need, in the previous slide that with a definable, LD definable set, I can associate an L definable set which is closely related, say. And we do this, for this L definable set, we know how to proceed, okay? And then you hope that, and assuming that you have a well-behaved, your dimension will, here we will really use that the dimension of a frontier is less than the dimension of a whole set. Under this hypothesis dimension.
In the proof you need it.
Yeah, in the proof I need it.
Yeah.
But of course it doesn't go further than that. In the proof I need it, okay?
In differential algebra we have a measure of dimension called the dimension polynomial of Colchin.
Uh-huh.
Would that
so this
be the dimension as before? Would that serve as...
So, I mean, this is the dimension without the derivation.
That's right.
Ah.
Okay.
But you don't even need it.
I don't need, no.
That's right.
But the Colchin, Colchin polynomial came into... So with X associated with this set Z, I suppose you forget all about it, but the dimension, the Colchin polynomial goes into this description of the Z,
right.
Okay?
Yeah.
But this dimension function is on L definable sets. We don't need differential dimension.
Oh, okay. But it would be enough?
Sorry?
Would it be sufficient?
Yes.
To what?
For this? Could you use it?
Yeah.
As the notion of dimension in this theory? In LD star?
No, but I don't need this.
But you might not need it, but I might want to use it.
Well, it's used in an indirect way.
Dimension before you even have a derivation, so how do you use it?
But you would have that, you need that for the dimension polynomial too, really. It's based on the jet, really.
So...
But the jet comes in only after you have added the derivation.
But
to have a dimension back in the original, say, real closed field.
Yeah, we would have that. Yeah.
But this is true that this Colchin polynomial comes in this description of the
set. And another question.
Yes.
Because of my own particular interest.
No?
When you have elimination of imaginaries in this setting, do you also have a theory of groups in this category?
Okay. There are a lot of works on groups definable in these pairs of dense pair of fields.
Right.
And just groups definable, okay?
But if the field has a topology.
And And also some have also some description of groups definable in this setting. But I mean, at least for now, I mean, I don't find. I mean, I can associate. I can have some description of groups definable, but for me, it was not totally satisfactory. But there are a lot of works on. So the idea is, can you use the description of groups in this setting to use it for describing groups in pairs of models of T? Okay. So, yeah, I mean, this is the natural question. Since you can speak about quotients, I mean, this is the next step.
The reason I ask this
yes?
is I've just become interested in the Tate curve because mm-hmm. it's created by taking the multiplicative group and modding out by a certain lattice.
Mm-hmm.
And if you expand it past the constants to have functions,
mm-hmm.
then you're in the category of differential algebraic groups.
Mm-hmm.
But it isn't combined at all with the topological theory. That's what I'm having trouble with. It.
Mm-hmm.
That this setting would be very helpful
mm-hmm.
to do the Tate curve.
Okay.
Because there already is a theory, and to try to link it in some way to differential algebraic groups, subgroups,
yeah, okay.
multiplicative mm-hmm. group. So the p-adic case would be what would interest
okay.
me,
mm-hmm.
and that but that satisfies all the nice things.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, yes, yes.
LP.
Yeah, the, I mean, of course, I mean to get elimination of imaginaries in the p-adics, you have to add
yeah.
a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
But yes,
imaginaries
yes.
would be essential.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going over time, so I just have 2 minutes. Is it okay? So let me go over. So here just, if you look at this slide, you can see dimension is used. So you use induction on dimension and you use effect. The key fact that is that you show that the dimension of this jet closure of the jets of this set x t minus x is smaller than the dimension of C bar. Okay. So this is used in this proof at least in an essential way. But this, I mean, at least for close ordered fields, this is true that there are proofs which. Which at least on the surface do not use the dimension. Okay, so this transfer of elimination of imaginaries was done under the hypothesis that you have L open core. So this is true for closed-ordered differential fields. So one way to see that this theory limits the quantifier, so to use a result of Dolik and of Steinhorn, Dolik, I'm forgetting somebody. And the fact that it's definably complete. So definably complete means that if you have a definable set, a one-dimensional definable set, then the supremum, the infimum, is in exist. Okay. And one way to show that one way to show that it's definably complete is just to show that. You can put a derivation on the field of real numbers such that it's a model of CODF. So it's a strange way to do it, to do things, but one can. It was not done. The first proof doesn't use that. And since R is definably complete, And since this theory CODF is complete, so you can transfer this property. So you can express this property in a first order way, so you can transfer it from one model to another one. And so if you want to apply this transfer of imaginaries to this theory of periodically closed fields, you have to prove that, this theory, this del D is L open com. So again, there are several proofs of that result. One proof uses the following properties of continuous functions, so definable in this expansion. So one shows that, so here I didn't put ACVF because, I mean, we expect that the result is true, but we haven't proved it. So for the free series, one can show that if you have a continuous LD definable function from an L definable subset of Kn, so for instance from Kn itself to K, then this function is L definable. And from this, you can deduce that this theory is L open core just for instance, if you work in closed outward differential fields, you say that a set is closed if it's equal to the set of points with a distance zero of itself. So you take as a function f the distance function to to so you take y an LD definable set, you take its closure, and you want to show it's L definable, so what it means to have L open core. And so you take, you define its closure as the set of points at distance zero to itself. So this distance function is a continuous function. It's LD definable because the set Y you started with was LD definable. And so by this result is already this distance function is L definable, so the closure of your set is L definable. Okay, so when in case of valued fields, you have to take functions from your field K to the old way, to the value group. So it's more or less going in the same way. Okay. So now a quick application to that sphere. So as I said, I mean, given a model of your theory, T star D, you have a pair of models of T, which is K and the field of constants. So assume that you know that the theory of pairs is complete. So this was a result of Van den Dries for your real closed fields and then extended by a lot of people, and among those for Antonio Giulio Fornasiero. So by a result of my one of the first slides, CK is also a model of T. So this, given a model of T star D, you get a pair of models of T. And so this gives you another proof of the fact that the theory of dense pair of models of T is L open core. So you can transfer results from our theory T star D to theory of pairs. So it's one application of, or one motivation of considering this generate derivations. So let me just go quickly here. So if you have a pair, so using the fact that the theory of pairs is complete by the Kissler-Schiller theorem, we know that if you have two models which are elementary equivalent, we have isomorphic ultrapoles. So from this, you can transfer results from use the fact that given a pair of closed fields, you have an elementary extension which is just an ultrapole, which is of a form K, and when F star now is a field of constants. Okay, when K star is a differential field, and F star is a field of constants of this differential field. So you can then, using this, say, cheap trick, you can transfer result from this theory T star D to the theory of pairs. And the interest in doing this is that for pairs, I mean, just the theory of pairs is not, if you forget about the derivation, the theory of pairs is not distal. So it's really when you do add the derivation that you get this model theoretic property. Okay. And so let me just go quickly. And so I just want to put this last result. While there is a result about graphs, and again, I mean, this way of going to dense pair to models of CODF, it's a way to transfer properties that you know about CODF to the theory of pairs. Okay, thank you.
Final questions?
Is this theory extendable to partial differential equations? I was thinking if you could do that, you could have a weaker kind of induction, starting out maybe with the most well-behaved field, mm-hmm. and then adding one derivation. But then if you had two derivations, you by induction could.
Okay, so certainly. Not. I mean, so for instance, Marcus Tressel, who also worked in this thing, did this year with several commuting derivations. Yes.
Arbitrary differentially closed field, what do you mean?
I don't know why I did differential closed fields of character. I just mean.
So this really just means the theory DC
doesn't
include all the funny theories we were looking at today?
No, it's just, why did we looked at this is because of the result of Chernikov and Starshenko who look expansion. I mean, series which has an expansion. So the way to prove this first thing is just to use the fact that if you take a closed ordered field and you add I, you get a differentially closed field of characteristics zero. Is there a way to prove it? It's why I put that result. Sorry.
What is a strong, in general, strong Erdős?
Okay, so this is just a homogeneity property on graphs.
Oh my.
No, but it just means that if you take a pair of subsets, it's either, I mean, E1, this thing, is either in the relation of disjoint from it. And you take E1, E2 as finite. It's just this. Just some kind of homogeneity.
Let's thank the speaker again.